days after the World Bank stated that Uganda was unlikely to attain the middle income status, the Uganda Bureau of Statistics has cancelled a media briefing that was seeking to address the public and let them know that indeed Uganda had attained the middle income status. The Bank of Uganda, amid its hiking prices of commodities and necessities and lately water, has put the central bank lending rate at 8.5%, and this, according to the deputy governor, that is Michael Atingi Evo, is blamed on inflation that has been influenced by external cost pressures. Welcome to the Business Show. Here now are some of the stories that made the business week. The central bank increases lending rate to 8.5%. Jennifer Bamtarachi appointed new Uganda Airlines CEO. Over 80 women in business acquire skills. UIA-URA to popularize local marine cargo insurance. British Airways to cancel 10,300 more flights. And the Bank of England vows to bring down inflation. Data protection for several agencies, be it government or private, remains a challenge in the wake of hackers who thrive on fast-developing technology. But with a report by UCC indicating that Ugandan banks are vulnerable to hackers, with losses topping 15 billion shillings, we ask what best can be done to protect such institutions and this new technology in general. This week on Views from the Top, we speak to an official from the National Information Technology Authority of Uganda, NITA.
Personal Data Protection Office is an office that was set up under the Data Protection and Privacy Act of 2019. The Data Protection and Privacy Act was set up to provide mechanisms for protecting our personal data. So to regulate and enforce that act, the Personal Data Protection Office was set up. You know, in many cases in our lives, what you don't monitor, what you don't follow, in many cases is never done. So this office is supposed to implement and enforce the Data Protection and Privacy Act. Of course, within that mandate, there's a lot more that we do. We do investigate complaints. We provide guidance, whether to private or public bodies, to individuals, on any issues related to personal data protection and privacy. We also are mandated to conduct research. As you know, most of the issues related to personal data are new within East Africa, especially. Other countries within Africa, especially the West African countries, have been handling privacy and data protection issues for a much longer period because they've had their laws a much longer period. But within East Africa, Uganda was the first country to pass the law, followed by Kenya, followed by Rwanda, and we know the other countries are also coming on board. So for us to be able to protect individuals, especially in relation to their personal data, it's also important that we do some research. Things like how does misuse of personal data affect individuals? How do citizens understand personal data? How do they utilize their data? How aware are they of their rights under the law and things like that? So we do audits also. We do a lot of creating awareness. The law specifically mandates us to create awareness. And some of these engagements with the media are intended to put the word out there for people to know, first of all, what their rights are, for those who collect and process personal data to know what their obligations are, what responsibilities do we all have, because it's a huge ecosystem that involves government, that involves private sector, that involves individuals like yourselves, that involves organizations abroad and the like. So it's very important that we preach this message so that everyone understands where they stand, what their obligations are, and what their responsibilities are. When we develop laws, as a country, we do a lot of benchmarking, but also it's important that we also look at our circumstances as a country. Now, when you talk about the issue of personal data, it is something, for instance, in other regions that has been going on for years, 50, 60 years. And there's a reason for that. With the advent of technology, a lot of our data is collected by people we know and those we don't know. Even when someone collects your personal data, they may not even inform you how they are sharing that data, how they are utilizing that data. A lot of us are using information systems or technology to make meaning of various data sets that we have. Now, when it comes to personal data, if your data is misused, it can profile you to your detriment. If your data is misused, it can lead to fraud, things like identity theft, which are now becoming more common. How we utilize that data is very, very critical. When you have your national ID, recently I was talking to someone who, luckily for me, understands the importance of this law. And one of the examples that he gave me was that when the traffic policemen arrest a driver, let's say a taxi driver or a boda-boda driver, most of us move with our duplicate national IDs. So you hear someone bragging, oh, I gave them the duplicate. But that card in itself is of no use. What is important is the data that you have there, because your name is there, your date of birth is there, your place of birth is there, your NIN is there. So if someone has this information, they can do many things. They can go maybe to a bank and pretend to be you and get loans, and this has been done. They can use your national ID to go and register for a SIM card and then commit fraud using that SIM card. So we need to be very, very clear on what we do. So these laws looked at other laws within Europe. We looked at laws in Ghana. We looked at laws in South Africa, which are similar. And in some cases where we have either similar demographics or we are within the same region, but ultimately we had to make sure that we customize these laws to our settings. What is common across the board are the principles. So in many cases, wherever you go, the language may be a bit different, but the principles that you're supposed to adhere to are actually the same. Now, when you mentioned national ID, of course, when we talk about national ID, we also talk about NIRA as an organization which collects this information and then issues us with national IDs. I'm happy to report that NIRA is already registered with the office. So they've started that journey towards compliance. Why NIRA is very important is because they hold most probably the largest data bank for personal data for Ugandans, because whether it's me as an individual, my family members, my children, everyone related to me will be connected within the NIRA database. So their registration is very good, because then we can engage them and start that journey towards compliance. The law defines personal data in a very wide sense, but basically this is information that identifies you as an individual. And that is why it's called personal, because it's personal to you, it is personal to the holder. I can give examples: your name, your address, your telephone number, we are talking about your NIN, your passport number, anything that can be used to identify you is personal information. In some cases, it could be information that is scattered, but if it's put together and you're able to identify that this is Twaha or this is Stella, that becomes personal information. Some of the benefits of registering, of course, number one is that you're complying with the law, because this is not something that we came up with. It is actually a requirement of the law. And there's a reason for that. When we sit here as the Personal Data Protection Office, it is not possible for us to know who is collecting personal data, why they are collecting that personal data, how they are utilizing that personal data. The only way we can know and be able to have oversight is when that organization registers with us. Now, when an organization registers with us, we are also able, having identified who they are, we are also able to support them. We have a lot of information that we've provided on the portal to assist organizations comply. Our ultimate objective is to make it easy for organizations to comply, because it not only benefits these organizations, but also benefits us as individuals, as citizens, as residents within Uganda, as business partners, because with a global world now, we don't only trade with ourselves. If you have an online business, for instance, you may be trading with someone in Europe where they have very strict personal data protection laws, so you're required to comply. So when you register with us, we are able to know who you are, we are able to support you.
Now, before we take a break, I want to share with you two tips on how you can protect your data from hackers. If you work on a system provided by the office, make sure it has a firewall installed. Use stronger passwords. Do not use the same password for all your accounts. Let's take a break now, but when we return, we'll share Pamela Rain's story, who with only 50,000 shillings was able to start an interior designing business and thrive.
The first money I used, I got 50K, bought a sack of cement, I bought some toothbrushes, I bought paint, and I had some old cloth around. I used it, made the first vase, painted it. I happened to be in town, I got a flower. I don't remember how much it was, but I got one flower, potted it and posted.